2 Timothy 2 says this, thou therefore endure hardness as a good soldier of Jesus Christ. We know the verse, we know the context. But he's saying endure it. Go through it. Yep. The affliction's coming. Jesus said they hated me, they're going to hate you.
Right.
Right.
The servant is not greater than his master. They crucify Jesus, they're going to want to crucify you. They just can't do it yet.
That's right.
They'll go to jail.
That's right.
But you strip away these laws, these little boundaries that God has put up for the little sheeples. You strip away those boundaries and we're going to see how evil men are.
Sure.
How much they hate Jesus Christ. How much they hate the living God. We're going to see it. Lord, help us to endure.
Yes.
As Paul endured. Amen. As you, Lord, endured. Everyone who lives godly in Christ Jesus shall suffer persecution.
That's right.
So it's coming.
Yeah.
You can call yourself an evangelist now. You better expect it to come. Are you enduring? If you call yourself an evangelist, you got to go through it. That's my whole point.
Amen, bro. That's good.
That's my point. You got to endure. That's what it says. Endure.
Amen.
And if you are afflicted and if you're going through it, man, you need to be praying.
Yeah.
Because God's going to lift that off you so that you can get ready for the next task.
Amen.
We think of that, Brother John. That's good. Praise the Lord. And the next word we've looked at, watch and endure. The next word is work.
Ooh, I hate it.
I knew I'd get
it.
I knew I'd get a rise out of somebody.
Oh, I hate it.
Get to work. That's right. That's a bad word.
Yeah,
it's a bad word, sir.
That's a good word.
Come on, preach it.
The word work means this. It says do the work of an evangelist.
Yes,
doesn't
sir.
It say that? It says to do the work. Is someone out there?
Oh, you keep title.
What's that?
Just the title, no work.
Oh, okay. I'm a worker.
Just the title.
Yeah, just the title, right. This is what it means. It was a huge, long list, so I kind of broke it down. It says business, employment, that which anyone is occupied. That which one undertakes to do, an enterprise, an undertaking. Mm. It also means an act, a deed, a thing done. The idea of working is emphasized in opposition to that which is less than work. So in other words, it's not that just you're doing stuff. It means you're really working. It means you're really doing something. You're not just talking about praying, you're pressing in prayer. You're not just talking about preaching, you get up off your duff and you get out there and preach.
Right.
Yes.
So the word work, I know it's kind of taboo in some denominations, but we forgive them. The word work occurs 176 times in 161 different verses in the New Testament. Wow. While the word grace, because this is what I want to emphasize, while the word grace occurs 156 times in 147 verses in the New Testament. So actually, there's more talk about work than there is talk about grace in the New Testament.
Amazing.
And this is why. The emphasis is obvious. Why? In the Gospels, work occurs 34 times. In Acts, 10 times. In the Pauline epistles, 74 times. He talks about work, working, works.
Yes.
In the general epistles, it's, you know, Peter, John, James, Jude, 43 times. It's actually a lot of times in James. But in the book of Revelation, 21 different times the word works is mentioned. There's some emphasis here. And you mentioned a verse last night, Brother Dick, in John chapter 9. And Jesus said, I must work the works of him who sent me while it is day.
Yes.
And the night cometh when no man can work.
That's right.
Jesus Christ, addressing the churches in Revelation, he said the first thing comes out of his mouth is, I know your works.
Yes.
The Bible says that all men will be judged by their works.
Yes.
So, God desires us to do his will, right? Do means to work.
Right.
To do or make one. And we are to walk in the works of Christ. So, I preach a works gospel.
Amen.
What do you think of that? I preach a works gospel.
Whoa.
But Ephesians 2, 8, and 9. And 10.
Okay.
And 10.
Yeah.
And 10. For by grace are you saved through faith, and not of yourselves, it is the gift of God, not of works, lest any man should boast. Here's the rest of the verse. For we are his workmanship, created in Christ Jesus unto good works, which he had before ordained that we should walk in them.
Before ordained.
Amen.
All right, don't start that predestination.
Preordained all the way back there. Amen.
You get your chance to preach later.
I'm just helping you out, man.
Thank you, brother. My point is this. We're supposed to be doing the works of God.
Yes.
Right.
We're called to do the works of God.
That's right. In Revelations, his servants shall serve him. That's
amen.
In heaven.
Oh, yeah.
And I really, really look at the suffering and the temptations and the things that Jesus Christ, our Lord, went through. But he was always doing the work of the Father. He was always working the works of God.
Amen.
Constantly.
Oh,
continually. And he would stay up all night in prayer. And the next day he would go out and choose his disciples and his apostles. He would stay up all night in prayer on the mountain. He'd come down and walk across and find his disciples sleeping in a boat or freaking out or whatever. But he was constantly seeking the face of God, constantly seeking, what do you want me to do next, Father? And we as Christians, if we're to walk as he walked, we need to be seeking the face of God. We need to be watching. We need to be enduring the hardships that come with Christianity, not just an evangelist. And we need to be doing the work. We need to be doing the work. If we're not working, what are we doing? We're sleeping. We're being lazy. We're not accomplishing the will of the Father. And the Bible says in Matthew 7, it says, not everyone who says, Lord, Lord, will enter into the kingdom of heaven, but he who does the will of my Father, which is in heaven. Same emphasis, work. What do you mean? You save yourself, preacher? No. Jesus died on the cross for me. His blood washes my sin away. But guess what? Now I'm called to walk in the works that he's called me to do. You better be doing the works that he's called you to do. I'm telling you, your works won't save you, but the works show that you're saved. How many times have you heard that?
Yes.
Your works tell me whether you're saved or not. Your lifestyle tells me whether you're saved or not. Jesus said, you'll know a tree by its fruit.
Yeah, that's right.
Good tree can't bear bad fruit. A bad tree can't bear good fruit. Supposed to examine the fruit, brother. The works. Which leads me to the next point. Prove your ministry. The word prove means to bear or bring full, to make full, to cause a thing to be shown to the full, to fulfill the ministry in every part, or to carry through to the end, to accomplish. To fill one, or the hearer, or the seer, or the examiner, to fill him with any thought, conviction, or inclination, to make one certain, to persuade, to convince one, to be persuaded, fully convinced, and assured.
That's right. Amen.
Romans 4, Romans 13, I won't go turn to them, but I have them written down here. Abraham, he was fully persuaded that what God told him he was going to do, that God was able to perform it.
That's right.
So he was convinced in his own mind that he knew if God said he was going to do it, God's going to do it.
Absolutely.
So there's no doubt there. He was fully persuaded. That's what we need to convey when we come up to preach.
That's right.
A person who's hearing the gospel needs to know that you're preaching to them about Jesus Christ, about the Bible, about the God of the Bible. They need to be fully persuaded. They need to know, hey, this guy, he's preaching the Bible to me. Let every man be fully persuaded in his own mind, Romans 14 talks about. Same context.
Yes.
Completely convinced. Let me tell you, there are things that you believe that I may not believe.
Yeah.
And there are things that I believe that I don't think you guys would ever believe. I'm telling you.
Heresy, man.
No, I got no heresy, you, brother.
Amen, preacher.
The point is this. Let every man be fully persuaded in his own mind. You know, people don't get nervous. In other words, if I have a doctrine or a truth that I believe it's biblical and I'm endeavoring to live it and walk it and learn it and study it and proclaim it, I really only get irritated or nervous if you don't believe it the way I believe it.
Yeah, right.
Why are you pointing at me, brother?
You get the point.
Yeah,
man.
I only get nervous or irritated if you don't believe the way I believe. And see, that's how the enemy gets in and brings division.
Yeah,
brings that schism into the body.
Yeah.
We need to be aware of that. Listen, I can't make you believe what I believe.
No.
But you better be fully persuaded in your own mind what God has told you.
Amen.
And you got the Bible.
The Lord taught me grace. Grace. Grace is to let you be wrong.
But you get your Brent chance to preach later too, bro. Well, another verse that I like to share in 2 Timothy 4, it's the same chapter. And Paul was giving this charge to Timothy. You read on in that chapter, and you see that he says, I'm now ready, this is verse 6, I'm now ready to be offered, and the time of my departure is at hand. I've fought a good fight, finished my course, I've kept the faith. Henceforth there is laid up for me a crown of righteousness, which the Lord, the righteous judge, he knew he's going to be judged, shall give me at that day, and not only to me, but unto all them that love his appearing. And then he moves on. He says, do your diligence, Timothy, to come to me quickly. Demas hath forsaken me, having loved this present world, and is departed to Thessalonica. So one of his co-workers went and backslid.
Yeah.
Took off.
Did he lose it?
He lost it, all right. I don't know. He might have repented. But having loved this present world, he's departed Thessalonica, Crescens to Galatia, and Titus unto Dalmatia. Only Luke is with me. And take Mark, bring him with thee, for he is profitable to the ministry, and Tychicus have I sent to Ephesus. So he goes on, and he talks about some wicked men who were doing evil towards him and the work that he did in Ephesus. Tell him to beware of Alexander the coppersmith. And it seems to me in verse 16 that he's trying to make a point. He says, at my first answer, no man stood with me, but all men forsook me. And I pray God that it may not be laid to their charge. And then he says this, notwithstanding, the Lord stood with me and strengthened me, that by me the preaching might be fully known, and that all the Gentiles might hear, and I was delivered out of the mouth of the lion.
Yep.
You understand? So when everybody turned their back on him in that moment, he said, man, nobody stood up with me. I was the only one who really stood up against this wicked Alexander. You understand?
Yep.
He said, but the Lord stood with me and he strengthened me so that the gospel preaching might be fully known. You understand? So we need to have our strength and our hope and our faith in the one who can strengthen us in those moments where we feel maybe always alone or everyone's forsaken us. And I'm the only one out there preaching. Like you said earlier, you know, I thought there was only four of us.
Yeah.
You know, in the whole world.
Yeah.
And so to make fully known, to prove your ministry, that is an edict, and that is a command by Paul to Timothy, and it's a command to the evangelist today. People need to know that when you're preaching to them, you're preaching the gospel of Jesus Christ.
Yes.
So the life of the evangelist is expressed in his words, his deeds, his manner of life. The work of the evangelist is a natural and fluid flowing of the power of God working on the inside, working its way outside into a verbal expression, a lifestyle expression of the power of God, manifesting itself in the fullness of God in perfect unison with the Word of God and with the Spirit of God.
Amen.
An evangelist is known as an evangelist. As I said earlier, he doesn't need to put it on a business card or a website or blare it like a trumpet on the airwaves or on some marquee or internet website or chat site or blog. You know a tree by its fruit. If I'm calling myself an evangelist, well, I need to examine my heart. If God's called me to be an evangelist, then people are going to know I'm an evangelist. You understand? So I'm going to leave you guys with a question. Am I an evangelist because I preach the gospel? Or do I preach the gospel because I'm an evangelist? Think about that. Think about that for a minute.